Any questions from the audience? Anybody who's got a question they'd like to pose to any or all of our team here? There's a gentleman there, first one, yep.
Yeah, hi, good afternoon. I'm Richard from Crewe. One of my challenges from the board is to offer our retail stock portfolio to our web clients. So therefore, the order would be driven to a retail store to be fulfilled if the depth of stock is not available in our e-commerce centre. Are any other clients of iForce and Norbert's doing the same thing? And if so, how are they succeeding in doing this?
Who wants that one?
Yeah, happy for you to go. I think
a lot of clients are looking for that capability. I think they're also looking for the capability to move stock between retail locations for an online order as well, for the growth of click and collect. So some of the statistics, sort of 40-45% growth in click and collect where there's a bricks and mortar presence. So I think they are looking to do that. There is a challenge around getting a single stock point within the system. It does become easier if you regulate everything by individual item as opposed to across a stock pack, which is more traditional in logistics. So that's where it becomes easier to be able to fill that challenge. I think one of the biggest problems at the moment is legacy systems. So retailers who have legacy systems that don't necessarily lend themselves to that way of working find it a bigger challenge than those that don't have those systems issues.
Neil, anything to add?
Yeah, I think inter-branch transfers and having your e-fulfillment centre as a last man standing in many cases is pretty critical. And I think all of us who go into stores and perhaps the product's not there, the expectations also increased about I can wait for it, but I maybe want to go back into the store or have it delivered and not pick it up on that day. So I think, again, being able to be nimble and utilise that stock pool and really, you know, not differentiate whichever channel it's from. It's an order, it's a vital sale, and therefore being able to move stock around those stores for you, even if the store replenishment's done from a different area, using that e-fulfillment pool for nimbleness is a critical area.
Another question?
Listening to all the panel members, one of the challenges that I, as an academics, feel that is how industries are responding to the low carbon issues within the supply chain, or is it all about cost saving? How industries are going about lowering, green logistics or lowering the carbon emission with the emerging trend like carbon capping or carbon trading regulations, how industries are responding to those challenges.
Okay, thank you. So how are we looking after the environment with the changes to the new way of consuming?
Obviously these guys are well placed to explain how they do it, but in the UK there's been a greater shift of not just delivering to homes now, but a number of companies now developing drop-off points, which will equate to mini line hauls of online deliveries to a larger number of different locations. And even in the last couple of weeks, there's a announcement of a Polish company that develops secure e-commerce locker boxes, that they're setting up a network in the UK. And that'll obviously have an impact on the miles. And you've got to remember, home deliveries are a very expensive and a very costly environmentally way of delivering goods, going down the leafy suburbs, delivering to a certain number of houses, and quite often you'll have some houses have two or three deliveries from different providers on a daily basis as well. So delivering these to a number of secure delivery boxes, and then the recipients either walk in, cycling, or driving themselves to pick these up, should have an impact and help to reduce that. What are your views on that?
Yeah, I think it's an interesting question. A lot of major retailers have been talking now for a long time about the carbon footprint and doing the right thing. Balancing that with the cost is quite an interesting one. So for me, things have got to change substantially within the delivery mechanism anyway. I think people expecting a parcel to be delivered for 50 pence down a leafy lane in the middle of nowhere, I'm afraid, is unsustainable. So I think these collection point elements will help with the carbon side, because they will make those drop-off and returns flow points, you know, much more efficient. I think there are some retailers, and Mark and I are about to bid probably against each other over the next few weeks, with a major retailer who actually specifies what that transportation piece actually uses in terms of its carbon footprint. So there are still some people out there who are walking it and talking it, but often when somebody looks at their principles and then looks the cost of running their business, they may well border on the side of the cost initially, because it's a pretty harsh financial climate we're in.
I think as well that the consumer drives what the requirements are. And it's our job in this industry to try and then make those as cost-effective and efficient and green as possible within the consumer demands that are there. So things like click and collect is something that's grown significantly, probably out with any expectations, but with it came the ability for a more green supply chain, because you're taking multiple items and delivering them into a single point to be collected, as opposed to the leafy lane or someone's home address. So I think with those trends that the consumer drives, it's important for us to then look at those trends, understand them, and try and get the most environmentally friendly result from that as well.
I think it's worth also mentioning that this is being driven by a lot of the parcel companies themselves, and I think the time of free deliveries to homes is coming to an end. Where with the introduction of either these drop boxes or collection points that have been Collect Plus, for example, and we spoke to UPS last year, and they who are really targeting the e-commerce business in Europe are now looking at bringing in a tiered cost structure for deliveries. It may be a free delivery to a collection point, but there'll be a surcharge for customers that want goods delivered to their homes. But Mark's absolutely right. This is driven by the consumer, and some companies want something delivered next day within a certain time. You've even got companies now, a company called Shuttle, who are offering 90-minute deliveries in a number of city centres on motorbikes and couriers as well. Now, clearly, this isn't helping to drive the green agenda. But if this is what the consumers are demanding, then it's down to the industry to find solutions, the greenest possible solutions.
Some of them are using the tube as well, I think, so that's quite green. Okay, any more questions? Gentlemen there.
Hi, I'm Gurvinder Anand from LG Electronics. As we discuss about the different multi-channel logistics solutions, like different companies, Amazon is using a vendor flex, and some other companies, like if they want to, like Tesco and Asda's, they want to, any customer want to click there for orders and it's fulfilled by the main manufacturers or main dealer. What, in the future, what do you think that, what is the future of like multi-channels or multi-customer sharing warehouse? What is the future of this in the UK?
Okay.
Yeah, I think absolutely. It's happening now. So there's a number of shared user facilities as well as dedicated facilities for e-fulfillment. I think as well there is a trend towards the manufacturer delivering direct. Of course, there's channel conflict with that, and that's a very sensitive balance for a manufacturer to have. Do they go through their traditional channels and their traditional retailers to get to the market, or do they start supplying directly to the market themselves? And of course, they can do that because it's easy to set up. There are companies like ours that'll do the logistics side of it, and getting it to the consumer isn't a problem. It's more about the channel conflict. So I think what we may see more and more is retailers and manufacturers combining, as opposed to traditional shared user warehousing for retailers, for instance, where they combine within the same warehouse for their supply chains, both to the retail aspect and to the end consumer, to reduce costs at both ends.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, does it give the manufacturer more strength again? Who knows?